SpongeBob SquarePants timeline. Hello and welcome to the channel. Today, we'll cover the entire timeline of the show SpongeBob from start to finish in detail. SpongeBob SquarePants is an awesome animated show that takes us on a wild ride with our main guy, SpongeBob SquarePants. He's a super cheerful and energetic sea sponge, and he lives in the coolest underwater city ever, Bikini Bottom. Get ready for some hilarious and wacky adventures with SpongeBob and his pals under the sea. It's pure fun and laughter all the way. So strap on your seaweed belts and get ready to embark on an oceanic journey like no other. Arrival of Atlanteans, 23,000 BC. Back in ancient times, a bunch of aliens called the Atlanteans landed on Earth and made themselves comfy underwater. These beings were super smart and had this civilization with crazy advanced tech, artsy stuff, and a solid military game. Their most precious thing was a million-year-old bubble from their home planet, and they treasured it like crazy. Little did we know, they were the ones behind all the cool gadgets and gizmos we see in the show. They basically set the stage for all the wild adventures that followed in Bikini Bottom. Squidward invents jellyfishing, 8000 BC. Life under the sea evolves for the next 15,000 years until Squidward arrives in the primordial sea and hopes to enjoy a peaceful clarinet session, but soon encounters a primitive sponge and starfish. Despite his annoyance, Squidward becomes caught up with their curiosity. However, their attention is quickly drawn to a terrifying jellyfish. Taking advantage of the distraction, Squidward tries to play his clarinet again, but the primitive screams as they accidentally shock themselves with the jellyfish constantly interrupt him. Thinking on his feet, Squidward uses torn pieces of their loincloths to fashion nets, showing them how to catch the jellyfish. The primitives are amazed by Squidward's impromptu demonstration of jellyfishing and eagerly accept the nets, embracing this newfound activity. Unbeknownst to Squidward, his time travel adventure inadvertently leads to him unwittingly inventing the sport of jellyfishing, much to his dismay. The discovery of fire, 6000 BC. Life under the sea has evolved, and so have the creatures. SpongeGar, Patar, and Squog, the ancient predecessors of SpongeBob, Squidward, and Patrick respectively, stumble upon the discovery of fire. Despite initially burning themselves while experimenting, SpongeGar quickly realizes the potential of fire for cooking food. The trio embarks on a culinary adventure, using fire to cook a variety of unconventional items. Their menu includes flowers, the top of a mushroom, a kelp reed, a wooden stick, a prehistoric ancestor of Mr. Krabs, seaweed flowers resembling corn on the cob, and even Patar resorting to eating his own clothes. They also find a green plant resembling spaghetti, and rocks that resemble popcorn, and even manage to create a makeshift Krabby Patty using sand. After enjoying their feast, SpongeGar, Patar, and Squog can't resist the allure of the still-burning fire and start fighting over who should keep it. Their argument comes to a halt when rain extinguishes the flames. SpongeGar and Patar apologize to each other, but Squog remains bitter. Before he can retaliate, lightning strikes him, leaving him charred. SpongeGar and Patar seize the opportunity to roast marshmallows over Squog's charred body, bringing a humorous end to their caveman adventure. Before we continue with the story, allow me the privilege of introducing you to today's partner, Atlas VPN. Atlas is your one-stop shop for any and all cybersecurity needs. A world-leading VPN service provider protecting you from prying eyes, cyber attacks, and much more. For instance, let's imagine you want to watch an anime series not available in your local Netflix. What do? Well, you open Atlas VPN, and with but one click, change your location to, say, Japan, and enjoy your favorite show without any holdups. Yes, it's that easy with Atlas. No wonder they have over 6 million satisfied users worldwide. If you're still not convinced, then what if I tell you that all the searches you conduct online and all the websites you visit are secretly being tracked by unknown entities? Scary, isn't it? But you need not fret, for Atlas secures your IP address and protects you from such prying eyes. And with the summer deal going around right now, you can get all these benefits and then some in a 3-year plan for just $1.83 per month plus 3 months extra. This comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee. All you have to do is click on the link in the description and sign up to Atlas VPN. After all that, if you haven't already subscribed, then what are you waiting for? Click the link in the description and grab Atlas VPN for just $1.80 per month plus 3 months extra before the summer deal expires. Thank you, Atlas, for partnering with us today, and let's begin the recap. Late old age. SpongeBob and Patrick find themselves transported to 12th century Bikini Bottom. They're brought before King Krabs, who initially orders their execution for an insulting song they sang. However, Princess Pearl reminds her father of a prophecy that two brave knights will arrive from the sky to defeat the dragon controlled by the evil wizard Planktonamore. Just then, the dragon jellyfish bursts through the wall, kidnapping Pearl and nearly executing King Krabs. Realizing that SpongeBob and Patrick are the chosen ones, King Krabs begs for their forgiveness and asks them to rescue his daughter. Squidly, Squidward's ancient predecessor, joins them on their noble quest. As they approach the bridge leading to Planktonamore's tower, our heroes encounter a formidable opponent. The Dark Knight, who turns out to be a medieval version of Sandy. A fierce duel erupts, with SpongeBob's armor getting destroyed in the process. However, his karate skills prove to be the key to victory. Showing mercy, SpongeBob spares medieval Sandy's life. Intrigued and impressed, Sandy decides to join SpongeBob, Patrick, and Squidly on their quest, hoping to learn a thing or two about karate along the way. SpongeBob, Patrick, Squidly, and the Dark Knight embark on a perilous journey to reach the top of the tower where Planktonamore holds Princess Pearl captive. SpongeBob distracts Planktonamore while Patrick, Squidly, and the Dark Knight attempt to rescue Pearl. However, their plans are interrupted when the dragon arrives and overpowers them with its electric blast. Just as the dragon is about to defeat SpongeBob, he reveals a secret weapon. A Krabby Patty he had saved for lunch. Surprisingly, the dragon enjoys the taste of the Krabby Patty and becomes obedient to SpongeBob, who uses its power to zap Planktonamore. With the day saved, the heroes return to the village where they're hailed as victorious champions, and King Krabs even begins cooking Krabby Patties for their newfound dragon ally. In the same time period, we learn that the city of Atlantis sank, and its remains were never found on the ocean floor. In the year 1304, the first Neptune dynasty took the throne of Bikini Bottom after the Krabs dynasty lost power. Victorian Age, 1400s to 1800s. In the year 1701, a great shift occurs as the stars take control of Bikini Bottom and vie for the throne. Due to his lineage, Patrick will be announced as the king years down the line. However, as the story unfolds, a surprising twist reveals that Gary, SpongeBob's loyal pet snail, is the true rightful candidate for the throne. During the year 1895, in the Wild West town of Dead Eye Gulch, previously known as Bikini Gulch, there was a new kid in town named SpongeBuck. All he wanted was to be a simple fry cook, but life had other plans for him. Pappy Krabs, Mr. Krabs' old ancestor, made SpongeBuck the sheriff of the town. And that's when trouble rode in on a dusty trail in the form of Deadeye Plankton, Plankton's ancestor. SpongeBuck and Deadeye Plankton faced off, ready for a classic showdown. But before anyone could blink, SpongeBuck accidentally stepped on Deadeye Plankton, ending the fight in the most unexpected way. The folks in Bikini Gulch cheered for SpongeBuck's victory and even built a shiny golden statue of him to honor his bravery. 20th Century. On November 30th, 1942, two significant events took place in Bikini Bottom. It marked the birth of Eugene Krabs and Sheldon Plankton, two individuals who would have a profound impact on the culinary scene in the underwater town. Their paths would cross and lead to the creation of the infamous Plabs Burger, a joint venture that showcased their culinary talents. However, their culinary experiment had an unfortunate effect on Old Man Jenkins Sr., causing him to pass away around the year 1950. Around the same time, the burger joint Stinky Burgers met its demise. The closure of Stinky Burgers presented an opportunity for Mr. Krabs to rediscover the Krabby Patty secret formula, a recipe that would eventually become the cornerstone of his successful business, the Krusty Krab. Sometime in the 60s, Mr. Krabs bought a bankrupt retirement home called the Rusty Krab. After some time, he paints the K onto the board and turns it into the Krusty Krab we all know and love. In the year 1972, Jim joined the Krusty crew. He would become the best patty maker in existence, even better than SpongeBob himself. Poor Squidward tentacles. Little did he know that his birth on October 9, 1977 would be the start of a lifetime of hilarious misadventures and torture, a courtesy of SpongeBob SquarePants. But you know what they say, life is full of surprises, and SpongeBob's relentless enthusiasm and naivety have certainly provided Squidward with some unforgettable moments, for better or worse. In the year 1979, a plankton tries to steal the Krabby Patty formula from Mr. Krabs, who leads him on with a fake recipe. The real one was hidden under his mattress the whole time. In the year 1980, the first ever Fry Cook Games event was held, which would mark the continuous rivalry of Mr. Krabs and Plankton. On July 14, 1986, SpongeBob was born. Even though the show never explicitly mentioned his birthday, SpongeBob's license in the episode Sleepy Time had this date, which is considered canon. But did you know that SpongeBob had his first ever Krabby Patty inside his mother's womb? The episode Truth or Square shows a flashback of an unborn SpongeBob eating his first Krabby Patty. August 17, 1984, the day the lovable Patrick Starr came into the world. Little did anyone know that he would become the lifelong best friend of our beloved Sponge, SpongeBob SquarePants. Together, these two would embark on the most outrageous and wacky adventures imaginable in the underwater world of Bikini Bottom. In the year 1996, Jim decided he had had enough of working without proper compensation. You see, Jim had been hoping for a well-deserved raise, but every time he mustered the courage to ask Mr. Krabs, the penny-pinching crustacean would dismiss it as a mere joke and laugh it off. Feeling undervalued and unappreciated, Jim made the bold choice to quit his job at the Krusty Krab. The show begins. Finally, we've arrived at the first episode of the show. In the year 1999, SpongeBob finally lands his dream job at the Krusty Krab. And guess what? He absolutely loves it. He's not just good at flipping Krabby Patties, he's a true culinary wizard. Working alongside his grumpy co-worker Squidward and under the watchful eye of Mr. Krabs, SpongeBob starts an epic adventure filled with laughter, a friendship, and endless Krabby Patties. During the same period, Bikini Bottom welcomed a new resident named Sandy, a talented squirrel scientist who moved to the underwater town to study its unique marine life. Sandy took up residence in her iconic tree dome, a habitat filled with air where she could conduct her experiments and research. It was in Bikini Bottom that Sandy first encountered SpongeBob SquarePants. Their initial meeting occurred during a thrilling encounter with a clam, where Sandy saved SpongeBob from harm. This shared experience formed the foundation of their friendship. Sandy then invited SpongeBob to her tree dome for tea and cookies. The following day, SpongeBob eagerly paid a visit to Sandy's home alongside Patrick. However, the challenge of breathing outside of the water became apparent, and both SpongeBob and Patrick struggled to catch their breath. Sensing their discomfort, Sandy swiftly provided water helmets to ensure their survival within the tree dome. In the episode Plankton, SpongeBob encounters the sneaky Plankton as he unsuccessfully tries to steal a Krabby Patty from the Krusty Krab. Later in the night, while SpongeBob is peacefully sleeping, Plankton manages to sneak into his head and take control of his mind and body. Forced to do Plankton's bidding, SpongeBob goes through a series of antics, even disregarding his friend Patrick along the way. However, Plankton's plan takes an unexpected turn when he fails to secure the Krabby Patty and ends up trapped inside his own computer screen. With Plankton's scheme foiled, SpongeBob remains blissfully unaware of the whole misadventure, returning to his usual cheerful self. Following that, SpongeBob rides his unicycle to Mrs. Puff's boating school for his driving exam, eager to finally get his driver's license. As he gets there, he throws his unicycle away, thinking he won't need it anymore. SpongeBob has taken that driving exam a whopping 37 times already, so he practically knows it inside out. But when it comes to the actual driving part, he gets super nervous and loses control of the boat, sending Mrs. Puff ballooning like a pufferfish. Thinking of ways to help, Patrick tries to sneak a walkie-talkie into SpongeBob's head to give him some handy advice. But oops, that's considered cheating. They both freak out, knowing they messed up big time. Looks like SpongeBob will have to give it another shot in the future if he wants that precious driver's license. A few days later, SpongeBob's house falls victim to a swarm of nematodes, leaving nothing behind except a small pebble that he keeps as a memento. Squidward, on the other hand, is overjoyed to be rid of his annoying neighbor and looks forward to a peaceful life. When Patrick offers SpongeBob a place to stay, SpongeBob soon discovers that living with Patrick comes with its own set of challenges, particularly when it comes to sleep. SpongeBob decides to move in with his parents and decides to bury the pebble while shedding a few tears of sadness. To his astonishment, the pebble turns out to be a pineapple seed, and within no time, it sprouts and grows back into his pineapple house, just as it was before. SpongeBob's plans of moving away are suddenly reversed, much to Squidward's dismay. After visiting Sandy in her tree dome, SpongeBob spots a rocket ship she built. Curiosity gets the best of him, and he begs Sandy to let him come along on her trip to the moon, which ultimately pays off. Under the cover of darkness, SpongeBob and Patrick sneak into the rocket and accidentally blast off into space. They orbit the moon and crash back down to Earth, thinking they've landed on the moon. They start netting everyone they see, thinking they're aliens with mind tricks. Even Sandy falls victim to their wild assumptions. Eventually, they turn on each other in a crazy netting frenzy, with SpongeBob coming out on top. But just when he thinks he's won, SpongeBob realizes his big mistake. It turns out the aliens were actually their friends from Bikini Bottom, who were trapped in the rocket's cargo hold. They gather around SpongeBob, saying, "Hey SpongeBob, we aliens need to have a talk with you." So, Mr. Krabs is feeling the need to jazz up the Krusty Krab a bit, and who better to turn to than SpongeBob and Squidward for some fresh ideas? SpongeBob suggests giving away free socks and having a double patty midnight madness, but Mr. Krabs shoots those suggestions down. Instead, he suggests live entertainment, and Squidward, being a dance enthusiast, jumps on board and proposes a talent show. SpongeBob really wants to be a part of it, but Squidward rejects all of his talents. In the end, Squidward reluctantly allows SpongeBob to mop the stage, thinking it's a small role. But guess what? SpongeBob steals the show with his mop routine, getting the biggest audience and leaving Squidward in shock. Squidward receives praise from Mr. Krabs for successfully organizing the talent show, and even SpongeBob's parents commend him for making their son a star. The episode ends with Squidward feeling a mix of sadness and jealousy, while SpongeBob basks in the applause. Sometime later, Plankton is up to his old tricks, attempting to steal a Krabby Patty once again. However, SpongeBob manages to foil his plans and stops him in his tracks. Feeling bad, SpongeBob tries to befriend Plankton instead. He invites him to join in on jellyfishing. They sing a song together, and for a moment, it seems like Plankton might genuinely change his ways and embrace friendship. But alas, his true intentions are revealed in the movie theater, where his diversionary tactics come to light. One day, SpongeBob and Sandy become totally obsessed with karate, and they start training and sparring together like crazy. But their newfound passion starts to take over their lives and work. SpongeBob gets so paranoid that he mistakes everyone for Sandy and causes a ruckus at the Krusty Krab. Mr. Krabs, always looking out for his precious Krusty Krab, ain't too happy with the chaos. He gives SpongeBob a stern warning that if he doesn't quit the karate antics, he will get fired. Sandy, on the other hand, keeps attacking SpongeBob, ignoring his attempts to explain the situation. Eventually, SpongeBob gets fired and goes into a crying frenzy. Feeling guilty, Sandy goes to Mr. Krabs and begs him to give SpongeBob his job back. Surprisingly, Mr. Krabs agrees, but he makes them promise to give up karate for good. They try their best, but karate keeps sneaking back into their lives. Even a simple picnic turns into a karate-filled affair. Finally, Mr. Krabs catches them in the act, surrounded by sandwiches and a total mess. SpongeBob confesses that he can't help himself, fully expecting to get fired again. But Mr. Krabs has a different idea. He rehires them both and lets them use their karate skills to make Krabby Patty super fast. Turns out, customers love it, and Mr. Krabs is making double the money, so it's a win-win situation. This man surely knows how to run a business. SpongeBob, Patrick, and Mr. Krabs get caught up in a pirate-themed board game called the Flying Dutchman's Treasure Hunt. They play for hours, ignoring everything else around them. Eventually, SpongeBob decides to call it a night, but Mr. Krabs shows up at his house, still wanting to play more. He suggests they go on a real treasure hunt, and SpongeBob and Patrick reluctantly agree. Their pirate adventure doesn't go as planned as they struggle to navigate and even crash their makeshift pirate ship. They continue on foot but end up going the wrong direction due to Patrick's misinterpretation of east. Exhausted and disoriented, they set up camp and try to sleep. However, to their surprise, they're standing right on top of the spot marked X on the map. They start digging with their bare hands and eventually uncover a chest full of treasure. Mr. Krabs claims the entire treasure for himself as the captain, but the Flying Dutchman appears. In a twist of fate, the Flying Dutchman mistakes SpongeBob and Patrick for the ones who dug up his precious loot. The lads are in for a surprise when the Dutchman praises them for saving him from all that digging. In gratitude, he rewards them with 2 gold coins. Mr. Krabs, on the other hand, receives a tiny plastic treasure chest as his reward. All hyped up from their Glove World adventure, SpongeBob and Patrick accidentally hop on the wrong bus and end up in the wacky underwater world of Rock Bottom. SpongeBob tells Patrick to wait while he goes on a mission to find a bus schedule, but in typical Patrick fashion, he hops on a bus and leaves SpongeBob behind. Determined to get back home, SpongeBob braves the long line at the bus station, only to miss the last bus by mere seconds. The Ticketmaster leaves SpongeBob in the dark, quite literally. But fear not, a friendly anglerfish creature comes to the rescue, finding SpongeBob's lost glove balloon and using it to help him float back home. Meanwhile, Patrick, oblivious to SpongeBob's ordeal, happily rides a bus back to Rock Bottom, thinking his buddy is still stuck there. As time goes on, SpongeBob becomes fixated on building up his muscles. Sandy, being an expert in fitness, suggests that he follow her rigorous training program. SpongeBob dives into the intense workouts, but soon realizes that it's too overwhelming for his small sponge body. In an attempt to impress Sandy, he resorts to ordering inflatable muscle balloons. However, his newfound fame is short-lived when Sandy challenges him to an anchor-throwing competition, and his lack of real strength becomes evident. On Valentine's Day, SpongeBob is on a mission to spread love and joy by giving gifts to all his friends. He teams up with Sandy to create a special present for Patrick, a hot air balloon made entirely of chocolate. However, their plans take an unexpected turn, leaving Patrick feeling disappointed with a simple handshake instead of the grand gesture he anticipated. Eventually, while sitting on a bench, Patrick's jealousy and anger get the best of him, causing him to unleash chaos at the Valentine's Day carnival. Just when things seem hopeless, Sandy arrives with a repaired chocolate balloon and puts an end to his madness. So, it's Employee Brotherhood Day at the Krusty Krab, and SpongeBob and Squidward are going to exchange gifts. SpongeBob gives Squidward a sweater made from his own eyelashes, but Squidward is totally unimpressed. SpongeBob gets all emotional and hands him a sweater made from his own tears. Meanwhile, Squidward is scrambling to find a gift and stumbles upon some pirates selling pies. They claim the pies are bombs, and Squidward buys one, not knowing that the pirates are telling the truth. He gives it to Mr. Krabs, who takes a bite, and boom! The pie explodes and wrecks the whole Krusty Krab. While Mr. Krabs believes it to be a deliberate attempt on his life, Squidward confesses that he bought the pie without knowing it was explosive. Later, SpongeBob finds the leftover pie and eats it, not knowing that it contains explosives. Mr. Krabs scolds Squidward for almost killing SpongeBob after all the nice things he did for him. They discover that SpongeBob has until sunset to live because the pie will explode in his lower intestine. Squidward feels super guilty and decides to make SpongeBob's last hours memorable. They do all the things on SpongeBob's friendship list and even watch the sunset together. Just as the sun is about to set, there's an explosion, and Squidward thinks SpongeBob is gone. But guess what? SpongeBob is alive and blowing bubble bombs. Turns out, SpongeBob had saved the pie all along for Squidward. But he trips on a rock, and the pie explodes, destroying the whole of Bikini Bottom. Talk about a pie that packs a punch! Just another day in Bikini Bottom with Plankton up to his usual tricks. This time, he's got a robot disguised as Mr. Krabs to steal the secret formula. Plankton lures the real Mr. Krabs away with a penny, leaving the coast clear. The robot, known as Robot Krabs, finds SpongeBob in the kitchen and demands the formula. But SpongeBob insists on initiating the secret handshake first, which turns out to be a ridiculous and lengthy routine. Plankton gets frustrated from controlling the robot for so long. SpongeBob still won't spill the formula, but he shows him a written-down version of it. Just when Robot Krabs is about to grab it, the real Mr. Krabs shows up, causing a commotion. SpongeBob decides to quiz them to find the real Mr. Krabs, but the questions backfire, and SpongeBob thinks the robot is the real deal. Plankton gloats as SpongeBob hands over the formula, but then the penny rolls in, triggering the robot's self-destruct mechanism. Plankton rushes back to the chum bucket, but it's too late. The robot explodes, crushing Plankton in the process. SpongeBob realizes his mistake and saves the real Mr. Krabs from Hans. They head back to the Krusty Krab, and Mr. Krabs forgives SpongeBob, but reminds him about the cost of the penny. Alright, so this one time, Mr. Krabs tells SpongeBob and Patrick that it's totally fine to borrow something, as long as they give it back before it's missed. Later that day, they spot a balloon stand, and being broke, they decide to follow Mr. Krabs' advice and borrow a balloon. But to their dismay, the balloon suddenly pops. Realizing they can't return it, they believe they've become wanted criminals. Panicking, they run into the owner of the balloon stand, but manage to escape before he reveals that it's National Free Balloon Day. They decide to leave Bikini Bottom behind, not realizing they never actually did anything wrong. They set up camp in the middle of nowhere, feeling sad and missing their old lives. However, they try to see the bright side, like not having to conform to society's standards and not having to return borrowed stuff. They even find two chocolate bars, which they hope will sustain them forever. But Patrick devours his bar in two bites and forgets, accusing SpongeBob of stealing his missing bar. SpongeBob tries to explain, but Patrick won't listen. SpongeBob offers to share his half, but Patrick still accuses him of stealing. Frustrated, SpongeBob eats the whole thing himself. In his anger, Patrick decides to report SpongeBob to the police, and they race to the station to snitch on each other. They both confess to their crime, and the officers realize it's a huge misunderstanding. Turns out they stole the balloon on National Free Balloon Day, which is allowed. SpongeBob and Patrick vow never to borrow without permission again, and the officers give them lollipops for their journey home. Of course, Patrick eats his share immediately and accuses them of stealing his lollipop. The Krusty Krab is dead quiet for a whopping 36 days, like a ghost town with dust, cobwebs, and even a skeleton chilling out. SpongeBob ain't having it, so he comes up with a genius idea called Pretty Patties. These Krabby Patties are painted in six fancy colors, but Squidward and Mr. Krabs laugh their heads off, thinking it's some kind of joke. Well, SpongeBob ain't one to back down, so he quits his job in a huff and swears to show them how wrong they are by opening his own restaurant. SpongeBob sets up a stand right outside his house, trying to sell those Pretty Patties. At first, it's a bit slow, but a customer comes by and spots a patty in his favorite color, purple, and suddenly thinks it's the best thing ever. News about the booming sales reaches Mr. Krabs, and he's dumbfounded. He heads over to check it out, only to find a massive crowd of customers going wild for pretty patties. Mr. Krabs congratulates SpongeBob on his success, but being the sly businessman he is, convinces SpongeBob to give him the rights to the pretty patty stand in exchange for the key to the Krusty Krab. SpongeBob, in his excitement, agrees and starts doing a happy dance. But the very next day, the customers came back all riled up, demanding refunds. Turns out those pretty patties turn your body into the color of the patty you ate. The angry customers want their money back, but sneaky Mr. Krabs has already made a run for it. He tries to get back into the Krusty Krab, only to realize he gave the key to SpongeBob, who's too busy enjoying the sound of squeaky pickles to notice. And that's how the episode ends, with Mr. Krabs getting chased by a mob while frantically trying to get SpongeBob's attention. Sometime later, a massive anchor crashes onto SpongeBob's house and Squidward's house, and of course, Squidward is annoyed to the core. He decides to climb up the anchor's rope and give the owner a piece of his mind, with SpongeBob and Patrick tagging along like his loyal sidekicks. Turns out, the anchor was dropped from the Flying Dutchman's ship, and setting foot on that ghostly vessel means they're stuck working as his crew forever. Squidward tries to protest, but the Dutchman throws him into some crazy dimension, scaring SpongeBob and Patrick into submission. The Dutchman reveals his plan to scare the people off Bikini Bottom, but our dynamic duo is utterly useless in that department. So the Dutchman locks them up, telling them they'll be his next meal. But they manage to swipe the Dutchman's dining sock, which apparently he can't eat without. Afterward, the Dutchman offers them three wishes in exchange for the sock's return. Patrick wishes he knew about this earlier, and boom, the clock turns back 1 minute, using up the first wish. SpongeBob wishes for Squidward to be with them, but little did he know, he had already safely returned home. Well, not anymore. SpongeBob gets the final wish, and he cleverly defeats the Dutchman by turning him into a vegetarian. With the Dutchman's true colors exposed, they find themselves in front of a pineapple that looks very familiar. But before they can celebrate their victory, they realize they've all been turned into fruit. The SpongeBob SquarePants movie. Canon ending. Even though the show has continued for like 13 seasons, the 2004 movie of SpongeBob was originally made as the series finale, so let's talk about that now. It's the grand opening of the Krusty Krab 2, and SpongeBob is excited because he thinks he's gonna be the new manager. Meanwhile, Plankton is hatching his evil plan to get back at Mr. Krabs. Mr. Krabs is all busy getting ready for the grand opening ceremony, and guess what? The Krusty Krab 2 is an exact replica of the original one, right next door. SpongeBob races to the stage, full of anticipation, ready to claim his promotion. But wait for it, Mr. Krabs shocks everyone by announcing that Squidward is the new manager. SpongeBob is devastated, feeling crushed and heartbroken. Mr. Krabs gives him the reason that he's too childish for the job. Ouch! That one stings! Meanwhile, Plankton sneaks off to King Neptune's castle and swipes his crown as part of his sneaky plan. King Neptune freaks out when he realizes his precious crown is gone. The dude is bald, man! Plankton makes a quick getaway to Shell City, pulling off his master plan. Now, let's switch gears for a moment. Patrick tries to cheer SpongeBob up by ordering a triple gooberberry surprise. They go all out, devouring tons of sundaes, and let's just say they have a bit too much ice cream and end up passing out in the restaurant. Neptune rolls up to the Krusty Krab, all angry and demanding his throne back. Turns out, Plankton left him a sneaky note suggesting that Mr. Krabs swiped the crown. Krabs, of course, denies the whole thing, but then a message plays on the phone, revealing that someone thanked Mr. Krabs for the crown and sold it to Shell City. It's like a setup from the heavens! Neptune's ready to roast Krabs for good, but then Krabs plays his trump card, claiming that the citizens will vouch for his innocence. And that's when our drunken buddy SpongeBob shows up, mouthing his boss for not promoting him to manager. Neptune sets Krabs on fire, and suddenly, SpongeBob snaps out of his drunken state and saves Krabs from his fiery fate. But Neptune ain't giving up that easy. He decides to fry them both, but just in the nick of time, his daughter Mindy shows up and convinces her pops to give SpongeBob a chance to prove Krabs' innocence. Neptune gives them 6 days to fetch his crown from the Shell City, or he will kill Mr. Krabs for good. Mindy, the ever-compassionate, hands them a bag of wins to help them return home. So, SpongeBob and Patrick are on their epic quest to Shell City, while Plankton manages to get his hands on the Krabby Patty secret formula. And what does he do? He starts serving Krabby Patties at the Chum Bucket. Plankton also finds out that SpongeBob and Patrick are on a mission to retrieve the stolen crown, so he hires this tough dude named Dennis to make sure they don't make it to Shell City alive. Meanwhile, Squidward notices that everyone is walking around with these weird bucket helmets, and something just doesn't sit right with him. He figures out that Plankton's the one who stole King Neptune's crown to get his hands on the Krabby Patty formula. Squidward decides to spill the beans to King Neptune, but Plankton's got a few tricks up his sleeve. He presses a button and turns out those bucket helmets are actually mind-controlling helmets. Poor Squidward tries to make a run for it, but he's surrounded by the enslaved citizens of Bikini Bottom. Plankton's got them all under his control, turning the city into his own little Planktopolis. Things are getting intense down in Bikini Bottom. SpongeBob and Patrick are faced with this treacherous trench and start thinking maybe they're just kids and can't handle this kind of danger. But then, out of nowhere, Mindy swoops in and shows them the devastating state of Bikini Bottom. Mindy gives our heroes fake mustaches made out of seaweed and convinces them that they are now men. They muster up the courage and sing their hearts out, passing through the trench without fear. But guess who's waiting for them on the other side? Yep, it's Dennis, ready to ruin their day. He tears off their fake mustaches, crushing their newfound confidence. Things are looking pretty grim as Dennis prepares to squash them under his spiky boot. But just when all hope seems lost, a massive scuba diver known as the Cyclops appears and snatches SpongeBob and Patrick, taking them to the surface. SpongeBob and Patrick find themselves trapped in a goldfish bowl, surrounded by water and pebbles, but their situation takes a turn for the worse when they're removed from the bowl and placed under a heat lamp. SpongeBob starts losing hope, believing that they've failed to save Bikini Bottom and that they're all doomed. It's a pretty gloomy moment, but then Patrick spots a sign that catches SpongeBob's attention. It reads, Shell City, Marine Gifts and Sundries. SpongeBob realizes they're actually in Shell City, which turns out to be a gift shop. But as they continue to dry up, their faces vanish, and they transform into real-life versions of their underwater counterparts. It seems like they've reached the end of their journey, and things have taken a serious turn. But wait, there is more. The tear of the Goofy Goobers finds its way into the power outlet, causing a wild short circuit that fills the air with smoke. This triggers the fire suppression sprinkler system, dousing everything with water. As the water drips down, SpongeBob and Patrick come back to life. Seizing the opportunity, SpongeBob and Patrick take the crown and make their way to the beach. With the crown in hand, SpongeBob accidentally releases the magical bag of winds, leaving them stranded on the beach. But just when they think all hope is lost, a hero arrives in the form of David Hasselhoff. Yes, you heard it right! The Hoff comes to the rescue, carrying SpongeBob and Patrick on his back and whisking them across the ocean to safety. With a spectacular crash, SpongeBob and Patrick burst through the roof of the Krusty Krab 2, narrowly deflecting Neptune's fiery blast that was aimed at Mr. Krabs. Neptune is overjoyed to be reunited with his precious crown. Mindy commends SpongeBob and Patrick for their incredible bravery, but their victory is short-lived as Plankton seizes the opportunity to trap Neptune under a massive Chum Bucket helmet, subjecting him to his control. The duo finds themselves surrounded by Plankton's brainwashed minions, but SpongeBob realizes that he has triumphed over all the challenges and doubts thrown his way throughout their journey. In a surprising turn of events, he transforms into a wizard, wielding his electric guitar as a powerful weapon to obliterate the brain control buckets. The cops arrive and arrest him for his numerous crimes, and Plankton is thrown into a small cage and hauled away. Neptune, now free from Plankton's control, reconciles with Mr. Krabs and expresses his gratitude to SpongeBob and Patrick for their heroism. He also realizes the importance of love and compassion, especially shown by Mindy towards the sea creatures, which leads him to become a better ruler. To make amends, Mr. Krabs appoints SpongeBob as the manager of the Krusty Krab, rewarding him for his unwavering dedication and proving that he was the right sponge for the job all along. SpongeBob ends the movie by jumping in midair in a cheerful state, exclaiming that this is the best day of his life. So this is the canonical ending of SpongeBob, who became the manager of the Krusty Krab, a place he loved to work at since the very first episode.